Okay. So, dear colleagues, I hope you had a nice coffee break. It's time to go on with our session. And I would like to present Dr. Chantal Eschenfelder now, our dear colleague from Frankfurt. She is the director of the Educational Program and the Digital Collection Department of the Städel Museum, the Liebig Haus Kulturensammlung and the Schirnkunsthalle in Frankfurt. Mrs. Eschenfelder is a member of the digital think tank at the Städel Museum. An important aspect of her work is the attempt to open cultural institutions towards all fields of society. So this is an important theme Javier Pantoja already mentioned during his intervention and talk. Aiming to enhance the digital resources of the institution for which she works, she is currently working on transfer of art education strategies into the digital space. For the so-called Digitorial of the Monet exhibition 2015, Digitorial is an important term for our international conference here in this context, and I hope Chantal Eschenfelder will explain us what it means. Her department and her team won the Grimm Online Award. And the title of her conference today is Digital Strategies in Art Education. So welcome to Malaga, and we are very interested to listen to your presentation. Thank you.
Thank you. Hello to all of you, and thank you, Carmen and Rudy, for the invitation to speak to you today and to present a little bit what we did now since almost 6 years, our work in the digital extension of our art education and of our museums and exhibition halls. So a quick view, this is the Städel Museum, a traditional art museum with a collection from the medieval times to contemporary art. The Liebig Haus is a sculpture museum, and you see here from sculptures from the antique till the classicism. And here's the Schirn. Schirn has no collection. Schirn is an art exhibition hall. And you see here the Basquiat exhibition from last year. So one of our core tasks is education and learning. And when we began to build the new wing of contemporary art in the Städel Museum, we were already at that time looking how society was changing, and today it's even more striking what we have to do as society towards this change. We have an increasing home entertainment, a demographic change, and society becomes more complex and diverse. And we have an increasing skepticism towards institutions and media. And this is even increasing because we have this phenomenon of so-called fake news today, which is not new, as we historians know. But you know that the debate in society is sometimes not the same as in science. So at the same time, people want to be more informed. And so for the tasks for museums in the future are to generate interest in the collection and to keep its topics relevant, as you told before, and to let people find answers to complexity and diversity of their lives, because that has always been subject of art in every time. And you have to create possibilities for lifelong learning and to open museums for a debating culture, and to create space for participation of the audience. So in our analog mediation program, we think that the diversification of the audience needs a vast variety of educational programs in the museum, because every visitor is different, and so is every visit. And we have different types of people, and you cannot serve one program for all because that doesn't fit to everybody. We are all individuals, and so the program has also to be diverse. And there is no target group in our view, because target groups normally means that you are divided in according to your age. But why do you have to send the newsletter to a young mother, 35 years old, only the family program? It's not right, because maybe this young mother is interested in a talk to a special exhibition, or in the Städel party we have to a special exhibition, or to another special program, and not only in the family program, and so on. So we have to be really diverse already in our analog program. And on the other hand, we saw through the years that our public changed. And with this change, also the habits of dealing with our artworks are changing too. So we thought that the museum has to have a digital outreach, and that was a fundamental change. And the reason for that was that we could observe that the number of people obtaining information from traditional media is decreasing in a severe way. Big media companies know that. And entertainment and private life is increasingly taking place in the digital space. So if we want to play a role as a cultural institution, we have to be there where the people are, and that is in the web. And for us, that meant that in the future, it will be even more vital to offer content digitally. And we have, and we are talking in Germany, I think also in other countries, there's this digital transformation of professions. And this does not only mean what you see here. The transformation of professions is in every sector of life. And that needs new qualification and skills. And there is a digital transformation of work. Robots are replacing human resources. But this is debated in Germany really hard. The question is digitalization an opportunity because it provides a revolution of learning methods, or is it a curse because it leads to an atrophy of social skills? There is a pro and contra debate about digitalization, and unfortunately a debate held with indoctrinations on both sides, at least in Germany. It's not like in other countries. And for us, it's not if it's pro or con, but it is either and or. So when we look at digitalization in the Städel, for us it was a look back. As you told, I'm very grateful to what you said in the morning, because this change is on one hand a change, but only in technical means. On the other hand, it's the continuation of the work we always did in museums, that means since 200 years. So for us, it was the moment to look back to our founder, banker of Frankfurt, Johann Friedrich Städel. And in his time, he was very keen on enlightenment. He was a great supporter of the recent ideas at that time of enlightenment, and about how can people learn with artworks. And so it was the fundament of his foundation of the Städel Museum and of the Städel Academy, an academy for young artists at that time. So we began with to formulate goals and a mission statement, because you cannot start in producing something without having an idea of where you want to go and why you want to go there. So the first thing was we wanted to expand the museum's educational mandate into the digital realm. we wanted to reach out to new target groups, and as you mentioned also, in our house you see 1% of our collection on display, because we have a lot of prints and drawings which cannot be shown all the time. And even the paintings and sculptures, most of them are in the depot. So digitalization is a great chance to make things visible. And we think it's time to use new technologies for the museum's core tasks. But what we did not want was a virtual reconstruction of the existing museum space. But to transform the analog to digital, it's a challenge of transferring also educational methods. If you think back, key features of art education in museums is using the impulse of the original, which cannot be replaced, on a nonverbal level through stimulating perception. And it's to convey information by the means of storytelling and the entertaining performance of the art educator, if it's a good one. And you have this close interaction between educator and visitors. You see if someone has a question or if someone is bored, so you can react. In the digital space, you don't see who is using your offers. And the problem, the main problem, is the average attention span is about 8 seconds. So how can we keep users interested over a long period of time? So key features of digital art education is to look what is better in digital than in analog, and that is multimedia content. Not only text and images, but also film and sound, and different maybe gamification effects to underline what you want to say. It is about showing a macrocosm in micro units, vast content in small units. It's very important in the digital space, because you don't have a problem to read a big catalog of art if you're at home on your sofa. But it's really hard if you're looking on a screen. You have to use interactive tools and gamification methods, and to offer a diversified learning environment for a guided self-study. Storytelling is even more important than in the analog, and you have to be very visual, and you have to provide example-based learning. So on this strategy, we built a lot of things, because also the variety of offers to a diversified public in the analog is even more important in the digital sphere. And in developing these offers, we always paid attention to the use case, to the digital user journey. You have some offers which are very good before you come. You have other offers who are important while you are in the house, and you have when you have been there, your interest is stimulated, so you have maybe more interest to look deeper and to get more informed than you have been before you have came into the museum. So if you look at numbers, we have not the numbers than at the Prado, but you have to consider that the Städel is really a medium museum concerning the importance and the history. It's a civic museum and not without ancient royal rules roots. Sorry, but what we saw was that we have a complementary digital public, like 2 million views of our website, and for example, we had a game for children on tablet. We have now 40,700 downloads. You cannot have as many children guided tours to reach such a number. So you see what the opportunity is of digital art education, you reach much more people with content. So a very important role plays the video. Of course, like other museums, we have a YouTube channel and we experiment with many things. We have interviews with artists, we have exhibition films, but this is our conservator and he's talking about conservation of paintings. But we also had an experiment where it was more for social media, a parody of talk shows. A humorous thing, because we have this in Germany is quite famous, Gerd Skobel. He has a real talk show on TV, and it is this parody is that the guests are not people but paintings. So, and on social media it was very successful, but in the Frankfurter Allgemeine Zeitung, a very big newspaper in Germany, they said, the Städel Museum destroys cultural values with this. So you have always both sides. But videos also give you a big opportunity to make people be part of something which they might have missed otherwise. For example, we have a series of guided tours in collaboration with the Max Planck Institutes in Germany, scientific institutes, and we invite people, a lawyer, or here it's a climate researcher, to talk about their subjects, but on the example of paintings. For example, to talk about the Little Ice Age in Flemish paintings that you have, for example, in the Prado. And this was not only this guided tour, because only 35 people can take part, but afterwards we always do a little interview with these people we invite, so other people can see it on YouTube. And now, as we have this climate discussion raising, we can again show this movie and invite people to discuss this subject, but with the sources of art. Or we have this, the Schirn Shortcut in the Schirn Kunsthalle, very quick movies. I try to show you. It's in German, but you can get an idea.
Warum ist das Kunst? Oder das? Und was macht eigentlich die Disco-Kugel? In einer Ausstellung. Lange galt die Qualität der Ausführung als Indiz dafür, dass es sich bei einem Werk um Kunst handelte oder eben nicht. Irgendwann jedoch distanzierten sich viele Künstler von einer realistischen Wiedergabe der Wirklichkeit und überließen dies der gerade erfundenen Fotografie. Sie wollten vielmehr mit neuen Mitteln zu einem tieferen Verständnis der Dinge und der Welt vordringen. Farben und Formen emanzipierten sich. Die Werke wurden immer abstrakter. Und dann kam Kasimir Malevich. Der Avantgarde-Künstler stellte vor rund 100 Jahren in Russland ein Bild aus, das die Malerei für immer verändern sollte. Sein schwarzes Quadrat auf weißem Grund war ein Akt der Befreiung vom Ballast des Gegenständlichen. Und eine Provokation. Die Kunst war mit diesem Bild bei sich selbst angekommen. Das Quadrat war alles und nichts zugleich. Eine reine malerische Fläche. Und doch sehr viel mehr. Sie selbst scheint es uns zuzurufen. Ab jetzt war alles möglich, zum Beispiel auch dies. Indem Marcel Duchamp einen bereits existierenden Gegenstand aus der Herrentoilette in eine Ausstellung brachte, durchbrach er alle Konventionen. Der Weg für das, was später einmal Konzeptkunst heißen würde, war geebnet. Losgelöst von ihrer funktionalen Umgebung, betrachten wir diese Objekte im musealen Kontext plötzlich mit völlig anderen Augen. Diese Werke haben mehr mit dem Verstehen als mit dem Sehen zu tun. Mehr mit Erkenntnis als mit Erkennen. Künstler der Renaissance wie etwa Michelangelo gingen übrigens ähnlich vor, indem sie das Kunstwerk bewusst nicht vollendeten. Der Betrachter wird auf diese Weise zum Komplizen des Künstlers und in der Konzeptkunst gelegentlich sogar selbst zum Akteur. Was ist wirklicher? Das Objekt, sein Abbild oder seine Beschreibung? Was passiert, wenn eine malerische Geste in Serie geht? Wie können wir Zeit und Vergänglichkeit begreifen? Und wie verändert sich die Bedeutung eines Bildes, wenn es mit Sprache kombiniert wird? Wir erhalten keine Antworten. Wir sind vielmehr aufgefordert, sie selbst zu finden. Und die Disco-Kugel in der Ausstellung? Eine sich sanft drehende Provokation. Sie ist Saturday Night Fever und eigene Jugend. Sie reflektiert das schwarze Quadrat von Malevich und Duchamps Pissoir. Und manchmal einfach nur das Licht.
Maybe you saw it was an exhibition of John Armleder, an artist of conceptual art, and this little movie tries to explain in a quick way for people who use our social media channels. It's a little explanatory video about conceptual art, which is a very big topic in public, because many people have no means, if they don't know anything about it, to deal with conceptual art. Here I run quickly through. In social media, is for us, it's not only important to tell something as an institution, but also to hear something from our public, what people do in our house, what do they photograph, or what are their interests. And we developed a new form called Digitorials. I run quickly through because you know this already. It's not only a multimedia in the case of film, sound, text, and image, but also visual effects that underline process of comprehension, so of understanding. So it is a contribution to visual literacy, and visual literacy in our image-based societies, it's very important, in we think. So I run quickly through. It's user-oriented, and design plays an important role. We have these special features like interactive image elements and image collections, and we have this meta levels, so that people who are more interested can find what they want to, but others who run quickly through and just read the headlines, they also have an understanding process. So now we have more than 500,000 users in 3 houses of all digitorials we ever had, and this means that we really reach with content people. It's not marketing, it's content. And it's more than we reach with audio guides or with guided tours or other things. So that doesn't mean that should replace the other things, but it's a complement, a very important complement. So users of Digitorials are a little bit younger, but this is more interesting, as you also said. Our physical visitors are female in the majority, but the digital visitors on the Digitorial is half-half. So we got new target groups, we got men. So this is our computer game for children. And the other thing was we wanted to get more into this learning tools. And we had, for example, if you have the objectives to recognize here the structure of the abstract compositions, the arrangement of elements in space, and the light effect and transparency. This is a painting of Laszlo Moholy-Nagy. Or you have here, you want to train visual perception and to recognize the surreal and the real. Or here, in this painting of Manet, many people today don't see that this is not a main figurative painting. They don't see the abstraction in this painting. And so what we created was this online course on modern art.
And why is it art if an artwork is photographed by someone? What is this all about? This is supposed to be modern art. Modern art is something for experts. Sounds good, but it's as wrong as most of the other pretensions about modern art. This online course will examine and explore selected works of the Städel Collection.
I stop here. You can see it on YouTube by yourself. It is also in English, and it is really it was the oops, it's been ich falsch. It was the essay to really get deep into learning into a learning process, and it offers you 40 hours, if you do everything in this online course, 40 hours of studying modern art if you want to. And the target group are people who did not study history of art, but want to understand more if they go to a gallery or somewhere where they are. And it's mentioned not only that they come back, for us it's not that important that they come back. I mean, if they complete the online course, they get two entrance tickets for free to come to the Städel, but if you don't come, it's no problem. It's more to mediate content of art and to generate interest in dealing with art, no matter where you are. So we think this is our main task, to spread cultural learning. And we have another thing, the so-called time machine. This was a thesis on the presentation of Städel paintings 200 years ago. Normally, it would have been a book in a library, and maybe five experts in the world would have used it. Now, because we had the opportunity to make an app with this content and with these the glasses, these 3D glasses, so now we do every month we do guided tours in our Städel Museum, because we still have the rooms 200 years ago, but not the same presentation. So you can put on the glasses and you see how it was 200 years ago, and you can put it back and you see a modern arrangement and presentation. So you learn something about museology and presentation, and that means that people are interested in stuff which is more or less a very scientific stuff. So, and our digital collection is also not only for experts. We observed how people are going through our museum, and everyone has his own path. We made a better version in 215, and we tried to show not only single artworks, but also the connection of one artwork to another. And you already mentioned it, you need many, many, many hours of work backstage, and this is art history work. You have to tag all your artworks, and we learned with the beta version, and we learned that projects are not like before, that you begin something, you implement, and then you have testing, but you are always working on the same projects and they are never finished. But it's like this in the digital sphere, and our digital collection today looks like this. You can start if you want. If you know what you are searching for, you can try. But there are so many people who just don't know what to search. So we have different albums of different themes. You can step in by a visual thing. Or if you don't know the connection between tagging and image, we have this little game. So you see three tags and the visual, the picture is changing according to the tags. And you have everything. You can start with very simple things, and here you get in your in a single vision. But if you scroll down, you have related works, and you can also search according to atmosphere or associated themes. And we have a very advanced search algorithm, but it's for everybody, also for experts. You even find icon class notations. So for us, it was very important that people deal with our artworks, even if they cannot be on display. So we have these interviews of protagonists, artists, gallerists, and so and they tell how it has been between 1960 and 1989 in Germany. And normally the interviews are two big books, it's like the Bible, but as we put it into a digital thing, it's like a montage, roman, a novel or a collage. So you really can search and you go under certain tags, you go into it and you can hear what Kaspar König said about an exhibition and what the artist said, and it's never the same thing. And you see that history is really a very individual thing, and it consists of multi perspectives. So also this is a part of making science accessible to a broader public. And now we are experimenting with podcasts. We have this Van Gogh exhibition, which opens in October, and we have six series of Finding Van Gogh, because this is the famous Dr. Gachet, which was in the possession of the Städel Museum, and the Nazis took it away, and now it changed the possession, and now until today. And today it's in a private collection, but it's never shown, and it's a mystery where it is. And we made a podcast out of it. And the next thing we do is so-called playable Städel. We wanted to realize a thing in the museum, for the generation of people who grew up with computer games, which are now almost 40 years old, and they have another access to artworks. And we were working together with a Korean game designer, which realized here something about the Berlin Wall and the Korean Wall, and it's in production. And we want to show in the house, in this game, also the connection between different artworks. So learnings and insights are that digital projects are never finished, and you have to develop, and you have to go through a big change in your museum. And an outlook to the future, we don't think that people as we are can be replaced by computers, but only if we work on it and if we develop our profession in the future. And for us, digital projects are not a source of income, no marketing tool, no replacement for a museum visit, but a great chance to increase outreach and impact of a museum to stimulate interest in art. That's our task among new target groups. And it's a means to transport cultural content into the digital realm, where people find information and entertainment and exchange ideas with others. It's a field of experimentation for new didactical methods and formats of knowledge transfer for a new intensive learning experience. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Eschenfelder, for this wonderful presentation, which was very structured and showing a diversification of offers created by the Städel Museum. I think this international institution, even though it's not no state museum, it's a city museum, medium-sized museum, is really offering a large set of different tools to experience arts in a way that they are not PR oriented. They are PR oriented, but not just for marketing, but for content. And I think this is a very important point. And an interesting point you were mentioning, it was shown in one of the video in German you were showing on the internet, the difference between artwork, reproduction, and description is an interesting part, because then out of that, in your database, you were creating a kind of slot machine, changing through different words, changing, and through them you have different possibilities to find objects going through these three different categories. And we, in the digital world, we're really facing the challenge to understand and to reflect very much about the difference between real analog object, a depiction of an object, and its description. So we are playing with these three dimensions. And an interesting part is of course the development of the so-called digitorial tool, which is not only a multimedia feature. It's not a video. It's not only a video, but it is meant to create visual literacy and it's very much user oriented, because the user can choose how much and which details he's gonna or she is gonna to focus on. This is an important point. Always keeping the attention on the importance of conveying contents. And the user of digitorials are not only women, but so 48% men are also using these tools. And thank you for this presentation.